In this video, I will be countering the long-awaited 3 vs 3 Jedi battle Evanova 95, Gensurai 1, and Ready 4 have been working on together for over a year. I overall disagree with the video's verdict, and have many issues with it, although I don't intend for this to be used against any of them personally. They put time into this project and still managed to complete it despite obstructions, and I simply propose a counter-argument. Hopefully, this will also show how to properly counter someone's argument online and in real life as well, because I've seen plenty of examples of people trashing each other on KMC and on YouTube, and of course real life. If you can't tell already, this is gonna be a long video, so prepare yourselves and get comfortable. As a disclaimer, and for those of you who don't know, Anakin is my favorite character in Star Wars, or at least one of them. However, this is not why I think his team would win, or why I think he could potentially solo Kenobi's team. I'm also a big fan of Obi-Wan, and this isn't going to be treated as a contest of favorites. This video will be objective as possible, and a lot of the discussion will be revolving around Anakin's power level in comparison to everyone else's.
As this is a team battle and not a 1v1, our verdicts are going to have a slightly stronger emphasis on skill and technical factors, as opposed to the even three-way combo of skills, technicals, and feats we usually employ. This isn't to say that feats will be disregarded, nor is it to say that if you took these two teams and only compared feats, the verdict would change. It wouldn't. We just feel that placing a stronger emphasis on skill is more becoming of a 3v3 matchup.
I don't have much to say during the introduction, aside from Evan saying that they'll be focusing on technical skill instead of feats. Feats are important, and depending on what they are, they can make technical and strategic focus irrelevant. This will be important when they disregard a lot of Anakin's feats and undersell his skill level.
With all that out of the way, let's get started.
This is where the fun begins.
To start off, I agree on the overall analysis on Mundi, physically, although his dexterity is undersold. While it is a weakness of his species, he was able to briefly compete with Grievous and forced Ventress to retreat due to his superior use of Makashi.
A 22-year-old human male, Anakin Skywalker was an exceptional, though otherwise typical, example of his species.
Here they say Anakin is a typical example of his species, and I think this is a good opportunity to go over the many feats of his that they overall, throughout the video, ignore and disregard. To keep this short, in terms of strength and speed, we can look to Anakin's fight with Dooku as portrayed in the Revenge of the Sith novelization. Oh yeah, and Anakin is actually 23 years old by the time of Revenge of the Sith. The first overhand chop of Skywalker's blade slid off Dooku's instinctive guard. The second bent Dooku's wrist. The third flash of blue forced Dooku's scarlet blade so far into the inside that his own lightsaber scorched his shoulder and Dooku was forced to give ground. Skywalker came on, mechanically inexorable, impossibly powerful. A destroyer droid with a lightsaber. Each step a blow, and each blow a step. Dooku backed away as fast as he dared. Skywalker stayed right on top of him. Dooku's breath went short and hard. He no longer tried to block Skywalker's strikes, but only to guide them slanting away. He no longer even tried to strike back. Force exhaustion began to close down his perceptions, drawing his consciousness back down to his physical form, trapping him within his own skull until he could barely even feel the contours of the room around him. Anakin, even while holding back, is almost causing Dooku to fall unconscious, and he's backing away as fast as he could, only able to send Anakin's strikes away instead of taking them head-on. This is something Yoda, Mace Windu, or General Grievous couldn't do. People say Yoda was holding back, well guess what, Anakin was holding back as well. Anakin almost kills Dooku in just 3 strikes. Whereas Dooku had to put effort into sending Kenobi flying across the room, it's made explicitly clear that each block and parry is costing him more out of his force reserves. This is how strong and fast Anakin is, and this is before Palpatine starts prompting the use of his Furnace Heart. This is when Anakin is still holding back, which Dooku even makes note of. Some people say this isn't impressive because Dooku is a weak old man, when that weak old man has been able to match Yoda evenly in blade locks, contend with the cyborg strength of General Grievous, fight on par with Mace Windu, and stand up to Savage Opress. There are three phases of the Invisible Hand fight. The first is Anakin and Obi-Wan fooling Dooku with standard uses of other forms. The second is them switching over to their primary forms. The third is the one-on-one with just Dooku and Anakin, where Palpatine convinces Anakin to draw on all of his power and stop holding back. Even before the third phase, Anakin was already pushing Dooku to his limits and was taking up all of his force reserve. Even ignoring the statements in the Revenge of the Sith novel confirming Anakin as the most powerful Jedi physically, it is still obvious that he's the most physically powerful person in the entire fight. The question is if any of the other Jedi on the other team can deal with his physical output. More on his fight with Obi-Wan later. And for those of you who bring up that Mace and Sidious were too fast for Anakin to see, Anakin had just been flashblind by a bolt of lightning, and Mace was amplified by the pod. Under normal circumstances, Anakin would be faster than Mace. In fact, Anakin defeats Mace Windu in the Revenge of the Sith video game, and Nick Gillard says that the video game is how the fight would really go. So I will be including Anakin's feats from the video game. Nick Gillard's input makes Anakin flooring Mace multiple times with his physical strength valid. Anakin. Basically, Anakin is capable of delivering strikes stronger than anyone else in the fight, at the speed faster than anyone else in the fight. If Anakin's able to exhaust the force reserves of Count Dooku, who's drawing on all his power, with just his strength and speed while holding back, he should be able to replicate the same from anyone on Kenobi's team, if he's unhindered. More on that later. So already, Evan's statement on not focusing on feats as much is already further shown as not the best mentality, especially when they disregard and ignore Anakin's most important feats. Not much on Kit Fisto here, except he is called the average among his species, which, while is true, his species is way more durable than normal humans, so that's something to be considered. His extra cartilage advantage is important in regards to Plo Koon, who is a Keldor and is thereby weaker than other species, which we'll get to.
Strength, speed, dexterity.
The three combatants are defined by their exceptional physical performance levels and their exceptional hardiness.
While Anakin is physically the strongest of the three and Kit the fastest, none of the three outmatches the other in any category. Each is a quintessential example of a Jedi's physical fitness and can trust in their companions to share the load.
Well, Evan got it partially right. Anakin is the strongest not only in the team but also in the entire fight. However, no feats place Kit Fisto anywhere near Anakin, outrunning the vacuum of space, outmaneuvering both Dooku and Ventress at the same time, or filling up Dooku's entire field of view with blue, which even Grievous hasn't been able to do. Plus, Dirge has fought Kit Fisto and Plo Koon both, and later when he fights Anakin in the war, he calls Skywalker the fastest Jedi he's ever fought. This is another example of why it's important not to disregard Anakin's feats. Overall, Anakin is the most physically powerful person on his team by far, which Mundi and Fisto should know. Their goal would be to support Anakin, who'd be charging towards the group like a bull.
As a member of the Keldor species, Plo Koon was naturally granted greater than average reflexes and endurance, average being the peak human level of these traits, and was noted for his physical strength.
So right away they use campaign and RPG guide statistics, which while a good guideline, aren't always completely accurate. They're good at giving context on the combatant's abilities, such as Mace Windu being credited with force deflection or 2 to minus, which I can easily see him using.
Keldor physiology also burdens Koon with a serious disadvantage in the form of his anti-ox breathing mask, which he needs to breathe in oxygen-rich environments due to his species' evolution in Doran's helium-intensive atmosphere. This weakness almost resulted in Koon's death when Savage Opress managed to rip his mask from his face during their duel, after Plo became distracted trying to warn an ally of an unfortunately fatal mistake.
Koon's mask is a big weakness, while it's only been shown being taken advantage of once in a lightsaber duel. it is still a giant target. However, I don't think Fisto or Mundy would be likely to exploit a weakness against a fellow council member and lifelong friend to make them suffer in such a way, and Anakin likely wouldn't resort to it despite what many may think. This is where I show that I'm not completely biased, as I actually think Kenobi's physical traits are underrated here. I made a thread on KMC that I will leave linked down below covering Obi-Wan's physical strength and speed. Evan covers this later in the Force round, which I'll further discuss, but for now I feel Kenobi's physicality is undersold, especially when Connor has called Obi-Wan's strength baseline. He also missed Kenobi's most impressive durability feat of getting sent into water from a great height. As you get higher in the air, the effects of landing in water can basically be like landing on concrete. The fact that Kenobi was able to remain conscious and swim to safety is pretty impressive.
Shaak Ti is a Togruta, and enjoys many advantages over her contemporaries as a result of this. Togrutans are naturally more resilient than humans, which, backed up by her Force enhancement, makes Shaak Ti not quite a tank along the lines of Malgus or Vader, but definitely an armored truck like Kenobi when it comes to taking physical punishment.
Shaak Ti's durability is above the average humans, much like Kit Fisto. But this normally doesn't matter in a contest with laser swords that can seriously maim on the touch. Regardless, she's definitely more durable than Plo Koon, as she's a Togruta. They also don't cover Shaak Ti's lack of physical strength in this section, which is a problem as her entire formula is banking on her being faster than her opponent in order to avoid meeting them head-on, much like Ventress, Dooku, or most Makashi users.
She is also one of the most talented acrobats within the Order, not far off Yoda's level of skill with them in my opinion, and definitely more aware of when and how to use them.
Here, Ready For claims Shaak Ti's use of acrobatics is not far off from being as good as Yoda's, and says she definitely knows how to use them more effectively. While the mechanics and physical statistics of their acrobatics are very different, I have a hard time imagining Shaak Ti replicating Yoda's feat of evading Ki-Adi Mundi, Stacy Tin, and Deppa Balaba in a sparring match while unarmed. Yes, Yoda is small, which makes it easier, but still, there's not really any solid indication of Ti doing anything even close to Yoda, I mean, even in general. As on the echolocation advantage, whereas they treat the physical Togruta trait as a Spider-Man-like sense, I personally believe that it's only echo wave-based like a dolphin. My understanding is that it functions like sonar. Go on to have Kenobi's team be described to have great synchronization, which while I agree on for the most part, gets massively over-exaggerated later.
Here we have the A-Team that represents the peak physical condition that combative Jedi strive for, pitted against a team including one Jedi who goes beyond even that, one Jedi that is high on the spectrum but is otherwise just too stubborn to die, and an aging, brittle-boned Keldor.
Here, Connor possibly claims or implies that Shaak Ti goes beyond the physical output of anyone on Anakin's team, which is inaccurate as previously established with Anakin.
Shaak Ti really is carrying the PloBiTi team here. She completely outclasses all involved when it comes to stamina, and arguably surpasses the rest's durability as well.
I disagree on Shaak Ti carrying Kenobi's team physically. Kenobi's strength is obviously above hers, and his speed should be greater given his performance against Dooku and Grievous. Personally, I'd place Kenobi over Shaak Ti in physicality.
She has greater flat-out speed and agility than every other combatant in the fight, and while not on par in the field of strength, she is no pushover here either.
Here, Callum claims she has greater speed and agility than anyone else in the fight, which I disagree with. Shaak Ti's speed feats put her around Fisto and definitely nowhere near Anakin. Andrew, just wait, you can get your glasses back later. He's like busy.
Wait, I think my glasses.
Whether or not Shaak Ti is a pushover in strength, she won't be meeting anyone on Anakin's team head-on, or at least will try not to, as it's not in their typical MO.
Kit Fisto, Anakin Skywalker, and Ki-Adi Mundi are all examples of the Jedi physical apex.
Anakin is the physical apex. I mean, he's the apex in general. More on that later.
Ki-Adi-Mundi suffers in the area of dexterity as a result of his Saurian binary brain.
Ki-Adi-Mundi's dexterity won't be much of an issue here. While he was defeated by Grievous, he was fighting someone who was using a completely alien fighting style and was already tired. Plus, his primary form is Makashi, which is dexterity-based, and he was able to force Ventress to retreat. Overall, they give the physical verdict to Anakin's team, which I agree with, although realistically, the edge would be much more significant. Both Ki-Adi-Mundi and Kit Fisto know how powerful Anakin has become as of Revenge of the Sith. Their objective will be to provide flanking support for Anakin as he freight trains into Kenobi's team. Using the feats that the three of them ignored, Anakin alone outclasses anyone on Obi-Wan's team. In the Saber's breakdown for Anakin's team, they don't mention Ki-Adi-Mundi's use of Ataru being second only to Yoda's, and rivaled only by Agen Kolar. This would make sense and is to be expected by someone who is personally trained by Yoda.
While his every move is performed with calculated precision to ensure optimal effectiveness, he has no rote response component to fall back on when distracted or surprised.
Distracted or surprised? He was surprised against Grievous' use of three sabers, and despite being at a heavy disadvantage, he still managed to last the longest out of all of the Jedi present. He was unfamiliar with Grievous' unorthodox form, whereas Grievous had complete knowledge of his, and Ataru is not suited to combating multiple opponents, or in this case, an opponent with multiple blades. It's also worth noting that Grievous specifically chose to target Mundi over Shakti in that fight. While Shakti was tired, so was Mundi.
Conservative enough not to overextend himself, but he doesn't always know when to stop, occasionally biting off more than he can chew.
And has Mundi bit off more than he can chew? The fight on Hypori was a no-win situation, and he handily forced Ventress to retreat. And it's not like he had any idea his clones were going to turn on him. In short summary, Anakin's saber skill is undersold throughout the entirety of the video. So I'm going to summarize this right here. And keep in mind that since George Lucas works on a system of levels, that all of these statements are completely valid, as if Nick Gillard's statements weren't valid for those of you who somehow think that. I'm really not sure. Or why other people have like a different tiering system.
Hayden in this film has moved up to a level 9. He's gone past Obi. Now the difference between a level 8 and a level 9 really is the dark side. You have to go through each level in order to attain the next level. If you do it too quick, you're going to get in trouble.
So Nick Gillard has Anakin up with both Yoda and Sidious. When those... Just read what's on screen. Anakin's Jimso is far above Plo Koon's, can hammer Shakti into submission due to him being fast enough to pressure her, and had he been unhindered on Mustafar, he would have overpowered Kenobi, who constantly had to retreat to try and break Anakin's momentum. Anakin's footwork isn't really grounded. He's not acrobatic because he simply doesn't need to be, not because he can't be. He's fast enough to catch up with Shakti and Kenobi, and his superior strength to Plo Koon's would negate the need to outpace him.
On the one hand, he overcame Jemso's immobility and amped up his offensive output, but it came at a hefty cost to his defensive viability.
So here Connor claims that Anakin doesn't have a lot of defensive viability, and claims his combination of Jimso and Ataru is a trade-off and leaves him vulnerable due to his lack of defense. Defense is literally half of Jimso. I mean, you can go and watch the Mustafar fight and see Anakin repelling Kenobi's counters. Anakin has been able to defend against Ventress, Magna Guards, Dooku, and Obi-Wan, using counters to prevent them from piercing his guard. He has also effectively defended against Sarah Kato.
If I have to keep you down, so do.
Anakin was guaranteed to either utterly crush the opposition or be utterly crushed in turn.
Connor suggests that Anakin will either stomp or get fucked over. Anakin is completely capable of using his intuition as he is his power. Even going by Legends, where he's had less lightsaber fights, he's still shown to be creative, and it's important to note that everyone he's facing calls for his use of Jimso. Dooku and Ventress are both Makashi users, so it makes sense that Anakin would take the initiative and charge them.
However, Kit's emphasis on this approach also stemmed in large part by his own inability to handle a head-to-head engagement.
While I agree Fisto does better against multiple opponents, this isn't a good example to show considering he's fighting Darth Sidious. Shaak Ti or Plo Koon wouldn't have done any better. Considering this is a group engagement, the weaknesses of Shicho wouldn't be as relevant. Fisto's specialization in this form is just as, if not more important than Shaak Ti's echolocation.
The most immediate thing one notices about this team is their combined offensive output.
As mentioned before, Anakin is basically the offensive output.
The two would go on to fight alongside each other once again, during the Second Battle of Geonosis.
By the way, KiAni surpassed Anakin's kill count.
Even mentioning KiAni's kill count on Geonosis surpassing Anakin's isn't any indication that he is a superior swordsman or combatant, as they were fighting droids and Geonosians. Not once did they come across someone like Ventress or Grievous. They also make note of each member of Anakin's team being familiar with each other, where all council members should be familiar with each other.
KiAni Mundi would take charge of the team. He is the senior Jedi of the three and has demonstrated his talent as a rallying point in times of crisis.
I actually find it likely he'd let Anakin lead. The Revenge of the Sith novel, KiAni Mundi and Agen Kolar talk about how Anakin is the most likely Jedi alive to survive a battle with Darth Sidious, while both Mace Windu and fucking Yoda are present in the room. In fact, they specifically decide to send Yoda to Kashyyyk to draw Sidious out so they can leverage Anakin against him.
And this is in the novelization. If we go to page 197, which is, I have the hardcover version, we have KiAni Mundi here talking about Anakin. You guys can read that for yourself. Agen Kolar says, and even if the prophecy has been misread, Anakin is the one Jedi we can best hope would survive an encounter with a Sith Lord, and they're talking about Sidious because, well, Dooku's dead at this point. Then down here is where they have Yoda go to Kashyyyk to draw Sidious out so they can leverage Anakin against him because they believe that Anakin is the most likely to survive a fight with Sidious.
So anyways, Mundi would tell Fisto to support Anakin's offensive, and I agree that Fisto would be taking screening action.
Even Sith apprentice Darth Maul, renowned for his skill and overwhelming arrogance both, considered Koon a great warrior, wanting to test his skills against him in battle.
The quote here is often taken out of context. Maul is unaware of Plo Koon's full skill, and just because he's mentioned in the same sentence does not mean he's the most powerful Jedi after Yoda and Mace, like some suggest. In short, Plo Koon's conserving of energy and defense will only get him so far, when Anakin's been proven to exhaust the force reserves of Dooku with just the sheer power of his blows. So even if they want to say that Plo Koon is on Dooku's level or near it, this probably won't do much. Kenobi's skill with Sarisu I agree on, although I question their constant use of ABC logic without context.
As noted in the Revenge of the Sith novelization, Kenobi's lightsaber defenses were sufficient enough to effectively stonewall Count Dooku and Darth Vader.
Kenobi did not stonewall Anakin or Dooku. Dooku wasn't taking an offensive stance because he constantly had Anakin breathing down his neck with Jimso. And as mentioned before, Anakin was constantly driving Kenobi back. Obi-Wan had to keep retreating just to stay alive. And had Anakin not been deprived of sleep or food for several days, and had the dragon inside of him, that's a whole metaphor in the novel, had the dragon not poisoned him, he would have won.
This was most evident in his duel with Darth Maul and Savage Opress on Florum, where his immense skill allowed him to hold off and even surpass the two. He was even able to slice off one of Opress's arms and drive the pair into a retreat.
Kenobi is often said to have defeated Maul and Opress. Kenobi was only able to take them both on with the addition of the second lightsaber, and the hallway was limiting the Knight Brothers' effectiveness. Savage and his long-ass saber staff wasn't very practical in such an area, and he kept getting in Maul's way. Furthermore, Obi-Wan never won the fight. Maul sent Kenobi back with a force blast, and had the ceiling not collapsed in on them, Maul would have continued to engage Kenobi. I don't hold this against Evan, as he's proven to be concerningly delusional with stuff relating to Maul in the past.
When Maul supposedly ripped that dropship down from its perch on Florum, all he did was take a ship that was already sitting on the edge of a cliff, yank away its landing gear, and let gravity do the rest.
As you can see, the shuttle starts moving before the landing gear breaks as a result of it moving. I mean, Evan even shows this on the screen, like, come on, man.
An active field agent and acclaimed military general, Obi-Wan Kenobi was wildly regarded as one of the greatest strategic minds of his day.
More like the greatest strategic mind.
Distinguished by his calm and calculating mindset, and his specific reliance on deception and diversionary tactics to accomplish his goals.
Kenobi is not reliant on diversion. He's completely capable of taking the initiative through his mastery of Ataru or his use of Shicho, Naiman, and even in some of his fights, Makashi.
An expert at using the environment to his advantage, Kenobi was fond of baiting adversaries and guiding battles to locations of his own choice, where he had the home field advantage.
Obi-Wan is a great user of Sokan, earning his high ground need. But on neutral ground, this won't do much.
She has completely mastered forms 2 and 4 both.
Here it's claimed that Shakti has a complete mastery of both Makashi and Ataru, but I feel it's largely overinflated. She is a master of both forms, but I wouldn't place her any higher than a 7 on Nick Gaylard's tier scale. Complete mastery would be Yoda's Ataru, Anakin's Jimso, or Sidious's. Or in other words, what would be a tier 9. Standard mastery would be more likely for Shakti. Some people take the line from the Revenge of the Sith novel of Shakti being mentioned with Count Dooku as her use of Makashi being near the Counts, when I find that completely ridiculous. The line refers to aesthetics, not skill. In that same passage, Depa Balaba's Vapod is mentioned among Mace Windu's, but I think we can all agree that Windu's use of Vapod is well above Depa's. As I've mentioned before, Shakti's formula is largely reliant on her being faster than her opponent to avoid having to take them head-on. This falls apart if she runs into someone like Grievous, Maul, Revan, or Anakin. Shakti's unlikely to take the offense, but if she does, I don't see her being a threat to anyone on Anakin's team. Her echolocation makes up for group engagements, but that won't help as much if it's going to be head-on. While I agree Fisto would be taking screening action, Anakin's team would be taking them head-on. They don't spend enough time emphasizing Shakti's shortcomings against faster opponents, which would be a massive problem here.
Parrying the blows of three Magna Guards with her bare hands, and using Force-enhanced speed to decapitate another with her knee.
They make a big deal out of Shakti destroying a Magna Guard's head with her knee, when this is something a Jedi Padawan has been able to do on a Super Battle Droid, which is more impressive considering Super Battle Droids, well, don't have heads. Overall, I agree that Kenobi's team has defensive mentalities, but it doesn't mean they'd be able to defend against Anakin for long. Plo Koon's strength by itself isn't enough to overpower anyone on Anakin's team. Same with Shakti's speed. While I agree that Kenobi's team can work together effectively, it won't last long.
So too do the two teams share a similar weight and skill. Where the differences show is between the team's respective approaches and mindsets.
Similar weight in skill? Statements like this are exactly why I put this section into my Syndrolling video.
And when I started it, I figured that a youngling is level 1. And somebody like Kit Fisto is 7. Mm-hmm. And I did take it to 8 and 9, but not many people know that. And okay. 8 and 9... are a cheat. Right? So Obi-Wan is 8, Yoda is 9,
okay.
Mace is 8, bordering on 9, mm-hmm. Anakin is 9.
there's a, it's more like leveling the characters.
So. Yes, but it's like a Richter scale in Earthquake. And so the difference between 7 and 8 and 8 and 9 is enormous.
The long-term engagement won't matter because they don't have what it takes to last that long against Anakin's team. As mentioned before, Anakin is capable of overwhelming anyone on the other team.
Obi-Wan is at his best when on his back foot. He implodes near impenetrable defense, holding off whichever offensive combination KiAniKit throws their way, so long as they could keep the backpedaling going.
While Kenobi's team would be backpedaling, Tien Kun wouldn't be able to last as long as Kenobi, and things would quickly fall apart. I also wouldn't put Plo Koon's defense on the level of Kenobi's if that's what they're suggesting.
Shaak-Ti, meanwhile, serves as the team's offensive counter.
Shaak-Ti won't be much of a useful counter here, considering this is a head-on group engagement where she'll be wanting to directly support her team members. T's best option will be to perform hit and run, yes, but it won't last long in such a tight engagement with people that are faster than her.
We know from past displays that both defenders can match what their attackers can bring to the table without question in the short term and reliably in the long.
Again, as previously mentioned, Anakin was hindered on his fight with Mustafar, and under normal circumstances, he'd be able to break the defenses of anyone on Kenobi's team. He also suggests that Ventress pressured Mundi when I find that false. Mundi was able to comfortably force Ventress to retreat.
Anakin and Kit both overcommit, be it Anakin in the Geonosian hangar or Kit in the Chancellor's office.
Using Attack of the Clones Anakin as a way to gauge Revenge of the Sith Anakin's tactics is just outright stupid. And they suggest Fisto overextended during his fight with Palpatine, but I don't think that's a fair analysis due to it being Darth fucking Sidious.
KiAdi may not be as overtly reckless, but he has bitten off more than he can chew on more than one occasion, most notably against Grievous on Hypori.
Again, he was the only one left standing and had no support. He was taking a defensive stance against an at the time unknown opponent and did pretty well given all of the disadvantages he was at.
Obi-Wan can't be directly overpowered.
Obi-Wan can be directly overpowered. Kenobi knew this, which is why he constantly retreated from Anakin.
Shaak-Ti is at her best when keeping the opponent at arm's length, but has trouble holding down a head-to-head engagement.
It would be the case with Anakin and Fisto. Mundi may not be as fast, although he still should be up there.
Problem is, the KiAniKit team can't capitalize on these weaknesses due to the limitations of their own approaches.
Can't capitalize on Team Kenobi's weaknesses because of their own limitations? What limitations? Anakin being able to overwhelm either Kun or T in seconds doesn't seem like a limitation. In fact, Anakin himself on the team is the exact opposite of a limitation.
Plo Koon won't be distracted because he knows that his teammates can look after themselves, so he won't trouble himself with protecting them like he did the clones.
Plo Koon won't be able to mount strength capable of holding off Anakin.
None of them can subvert Kenobi because all of their styles are based on direct offense.
Yeah, a direct offense that came very close to cutting Kenobi down in several different parts of the Mustafar fight, which is why he constantly retreated.
And the only one who is powerful enough to overwhelm Shaak-Ti is Anakin.
Okay, I agree with this, although I'd say Fisto and Mundi both have a pretty decent chance.
And even then, it would take him a while.
No, I really don't think it would. We don't have any solid confirmation that they fought during Operation Nightfall. Anakin during that event would, well, stomp Shaak-Ti in seconds, so I don't find it realistic at all that she was able to hold him off.
Kit Fisto, no matter who he goes up against, is facing someone who is perfectly optimized to deflect his wild flurries and slip encounters, cutting him down.
This I'm not so sure on. While I wouldn't solidly place him over T or Kun, I still think he'd be able to defend against them.
While Anakin can maintain defensive coverage while locking in a head-to-head bout, his reckless acrobatic maneuvers were his downfall against Kenobi, and would be prime for Plo and T to exploit any day of the week.
Anakin wouldn't be maintaining defensive coverage, and his reckless acrobatics weren't his downfall. He was winning up until that point, until he made a stupid-ass decision to attack Kenobi on the high ground. Plo Koon and Shaak-Ti wouldn't be exploiting acrobatics if Anakin's barreling through them like my parrot trying to get to his food. I also want to take this moment to further establish how Anakin lost on Mustafar. Kenobi constantly had to retreat just to stay alive, even putting himself in danger to get away from Anakin. It wasn't until he challenged and enraged Anakin to attack him from the high ground where he was able to cut Skywalker down. It doesn't matter if you put Plo Koon, Shaak Ti, Kit Fisto, Count Dooku, or Mace Windu in that situation. If they tried to execute such a stupid-ass maneuver, they would have been cut down. Even if an incompetent fuck like Coleman Trevor was on the high ground, they still would have lost. So, no, I don't think this is a fair judgment with Anakin's skill with acrobatics. Neither is using Shaak Ti's fight against Galen Merrick, who is nowhere near Anakin's level. Especially when they said earlier that Anakin's footwork was grounded.
Ki-Adi's consistency makes him a tougher nut to crack, but his stubborn persistence would allow him to be led by the nose by the opposing Jedi and ultimately brought to heel through attrition.
I'd argue Mundi would be capable of eventually taking Ti or Koon down in a one-on-one, not that it would matter with Anakin present. This section, they go on to say that Anakin's team focuses more on direct usage of a few forms, which is fine, although I'd argue Mundi isn't this way. If their point is that Team Kenobi is more defensively viable and is more likely to adapt, then they can have that. But that's not going to matter if none of them can stop Anakin from steamrolling them except for Kenobi. I know, I'm getting tired of saying this too. Okay, so for this section, I don't really have that much to say on Mundi. I mostly agree with their force breakdown of them. As for Anakin, I already covered how ridiculous his physical augmentation is. For the rest of his breakdown, I wanted to address a massive misconception people seem to have on Anakin. This is about Anakin's force feats, but could easily apply to anything else. Many believe Anakin can only achieve his best feats when in the zone, or when he's Zonakin. Zonakin simply doesn't exist. Leading up to and during Revenge of the Sith, Anakin is capable of achieving his apex state, but chooses not to because he's holding back and fearful of his full power and what he could possibly do to others. During his fight with Dooku, the Count makes explicit note of how even though Anakin's driving Dooku to his limits, he's still holding back out of fear of what would happen if he allowed himself to get stronger. Anakin is capable of unleashing his power in displays like ragdolling Ventress, tearing apart a giant spider droid, shattering a giant dome, breaking the force wall of Count Dooku, and moving large-ass objects whenever he wants. He's just too fearful of what could happen if he does. I don't agree with Evan Nova's analysis of Plagueis, but I feel if you took it and applied it to Anakin, it'd fit right in. Anakin does have the power to one-shot a bunch of people like Kit Fisto and Shaak Ti. He just won't because he's reluctant to use that power. Just as Anakin was hindered on Mustafar, he was also hindered on the Invisible Hand. The only time Anakin is truly unhindered, or at least close to being so, is during Operation Nightfall. Anakin metaphorically crushing the dragon under Anakin metaphorically crushing the dragon under his heel is basically himself giving himself permission to use his full power at its full capacity, not to be confused with his full potential. I personally believe George Lucas's statements on Anakin implying that he is on the level of Yoda and Sidious in the Force.
Now he's half machine and half man, so he's lost a lot of the power of the Force, and he's lost a lot of his ability to be more powerful than the Emperor.
George Lucas says he's lost both power and potential. Even going by just feats, when taking Anakin being able to achieve his best feats when he lets himself go, he should be able to ragdoll tier 7s like Shaak Ti and Plo Koon. This taken with Lucas's statements on Darth Vader being 80% of Palpatine's power, further implies that during Revenge of the Sith, Anakin was as strong as Sidious, even if we ignore Lucas basically saying so.
He was versed in the basic mind trick and appeared to possess a limited faculty with force concealment, which allowed him to mask his force signature from other adepts, though it's never been established whether or not he can cloak himself from beings who were actively trying to seek him out.
Not much to say on Fisto except that I wouldn't say hiding from Grievous is a showing of force concealment, since the general is not force sensitive.
Just as with their martial arts skills, this team's greatest asset is the direct application of power.
The team's greatest asset is Anakin. Like in Sabers, the team would be providing support roles for Anakin in the Force, if he needed it.
He is the most powerful Force-sensitive in existence, yet he is not completely in control of himself or his power.
I'd say Anakin is in control of it for reasons I just mentioned. It's just a matter of when he feels like he needs to use it, or if something comes up and he does need to use it.
Oftentimes, Anakin gets so caught up in Force channeling that he fails to make effective use of his active abilities.
No, Anakin can use his active abilities pretty well. For the rest of this section, I agree. Plo Koon's summary is utility tools in the Force wouldn't be that useful, and I disagree that his telekinesis is around Dooku's. No feats that I've been able to find put him on that level.
He has used such powerful attacks, and has even penetrated the Force shields used to defend against such methods, a notable feat even among Jedi Masters.
Plo Koon Force-pushing Ventress, who's Force-pushed Anakin, isn't anything to indicate his superiority over Anakin Skywalker in a TV show where Force barriers are almost non-existent. I could just as easily cite the source of Anakin ragdolling Ventress later in the war.
With that in mind, we come to Plo's most infamous Force ability, Electric Judgment.
Electric Judgment is something Koon's unlikely to use against fellow Jedi, and I don't see him being pushed to the point where he'd feel he needs to use it.
These capabilities were reinforced by his mastery of Force speed and breath control.
Here, Evan uses ABC ordering again for the dueling speed of Anakin, Dooku, Yoda, and the Magna Guards. Anakin and Obi-Wan were literally fighting Grievous' top bodyguards, and Yoda and Anakin were both holding back to some extent. I agree with the assessment of Kenobi's Force abilities as a whole, except calling him manipulating Anakin's mechanical arm effortless, as Anakin was hindered by his rage and suffering from CIS. As for Shakti, the magnitude of her power and physical augmentation is overblown. Her breaking Galen Merrick's Force wall isn't that hard to do considering how weak it is, and her being amped on a light side nexus doesn't speak to her power. This part of the video confused me because if anything, it's speaking against her power.
T's aptitude for telekinesis is devastating. She is able to hurl large objects at high speeds with apparent ease.
So can Anakin.
And her force pushes are capable of blasting solid objects into craters.
Like Anakin hasn't blown through walls before.
Shakti, the most overtly powerful of the three, is always looking for the moment she can hit you with a bullet train.
I'd personally say Kenobi is the most overtly powerful when he completely unrestrains himself in the Force.
Anakin Skywalker is without a doubt the most powerful, not just of his team, but of all present, technically ever.
Agreed.
If he had ever lived up to his potential, KiAdi and Kit could take a nap for all the difference it would make to the team's outcome.
They could probably take a nap regardless.
The problem is that Anakin did not live up to his potential and does not make effective and full use of his power.
I disagree on this due to my previous assessment of Anakin's power.
There is no question that had Anakin been able to channel this power at will, and not just in response to rage-inducing failure, he would crush PloBiTi in a Force duel. As it stands, he is merely another of the Jedi's big guns.
Anakin is the Jedi's big gun, and Kenobi even says Anakin's a brigade's worth of firepower in the Revenge of the Sith novelization.
These two teams share a comparable level of power, neither one having any particular advantage over the other in the scale of Force abilities they are bringing to the table.
Yes, but it's like a Richter scale, an earthquake, and so the difference between 7 and 8 and 8 and 9 is enormous.
Plo is versatile enough to defend against anything leveled against him, but has no specific strengths to leverage and can be overpowered.
I don't see Plo Koon being able to defend against Anakin's Force waves or telekinetic grips.
While they are more than capable of taking the direct approach when necessary, their greatest edge is ultimately subversion and tactical ingenuity.
If they want to say that everyone on Team Kenobi is more tactically inclined than Anakin's team, okay, sure, but they've ignored a lot of Anakin's feats and power level description that makes it so that he'd be able to deal with their subversions.
None of the KiAniKit team has any skill with Tutaminus, so Plo Koon gets an automatic free ride with his electric judgment.
Actually, Anakin can use Tutaminus in both Legends and canon. In Legends, he uses Tutaminus while on an undercover mission without his lightsaber to deflect blaster fire from a spider droid, and in canon, he uses it again to deflect a fucking bolt of lightning from the Theta store. Oh my god, so in one of my random moment, in one of my classes, the teacher asked this kid what the number 4911 was, and the kid didn't know. Then they asked him again, what is the number for 911? And he still didn't know.
Shaak Ti, meanwhile, commands a similar level of magnitude as Anakin Skywalker.
You are either lying or you're stupid.
Anakin may be the most powerful one present, but he is also the least skilled of all present.
The least skilled? I guess we'll ignore his usage of Force Heal, Tutaminus, and him trying to revive someone by Force influencing their heart. Anakin is just as capable as manipulating smaller objects and using his environment to his advantage.
His more relevant weakness is simply his lack of power.
Lack of power? I'd say Mundi has plenty of power. In short, an unhindered Anakin can overpower any one of them in the Force, and I don't think his team would be vulnerable to tactical subversions. The tactical subversions are why they give Team Kenobi the edge, whereas little suggests they can deal with Anakin's full power. She's not your average lady, she is fucking crazy. Spelled C-U-N-T. And after all the rise and fall, you're not worth my time. Oh, I can assure you, this is where the fun begins.
It's worth noting that they are not incapable of adopting a defensive stance. We are simply saying that doing so is almost never their first instinct, and they lack experience in this area when compared to their opponents.
Again, Anakin and Mundi's defense is underestimated.
Looking at these two mirrored teams, on paper you may suspect an impasse.
On paper, we'd expect Anakin to godstomp Shaak Ti and Plo Koon.
They're good at exploiting enemy's mistakes, but creating openings on the tactical front is not in their nature.
I'd say Fisto managing to get a hold of Nadar's saber and Anakin luring Dirge into an escape pod is creating an opening. Same with Anakin using his Force Wall to box Count Dooku in and prevent his retreat. Or Anakin getting a hold of Varys' saber, knowing that she had both of Ventress's. The reason why it's not as obvious is because they're on the offense, where pressing saber skills is at the forefront.
These are Jedi that let go of everything but their immediate intent. Death Star trench runners. Not Jedi that truly let go of everything, their open mindsets feeding not just their spirituality, but their nuanced tactical talents.
Master, you can make it, but everyone else is getting shot down. Master!
Should have performed better. You were brilliant. What more could you have done? I should have gone closer to the edge, Kit said. Released myself into the Force. Become more unpredictable, more random.
That would have been dangerous, Obi-Wan said. Not to your body, perhaps, but to your spirit. Kit looked up at him.
It is the way of Form One.
Everyone out! No! We must pursue!
General, we can't. The survivors will die.
As if Team Kenobi hasn't had their share of equally bad examples.
So that's how I work on his
You know, his downfall is going to be aggression. Obi is also aggressive. They're almost the same, those two, because they've learned, they've come up through the same way, taught by Qui-Gon, Tyrannus, Yoda. It's the same line. They are sort of mirror images, but they're certainly different. They just match each other perfectly.
You're tired, Jedi.
Conservative KiAniKit, Fisto and Anakin are forces to be reckoned with by most standards, certainly, but not at the bracket of council-level combat they operate on when truly letting themselves go.
All but Kit proving that their approach just needed to be amped up to bully through her interference.
KiAdi forced Ventress to retreat, and Anakin didn't really get another option as Ventress kept running away from him.
Blunts KiAniKit's effectiveness against the type of threat PloBiTi represents.
Here is what I mentioned earlier on them suggesting Plo Koon can KO Anakin with electric judgment, which I proved wrong since it wouldn't do fuck.
In terms of raw force power, only T compares to Anakin and Kit's overwhelming output.
In terms of raw power, Anakin eats Shaak Ti for breakfast.
But in terms of application, each member of the PloBiTi team sweeps the board. Variety, precision, timing, intent. Team PloBiTi takes the gold in all.
At this point, I'm not even going to bother bringing up my argument again and repeat myself.
And if he misses one of those necessary moments, his attention focused elsewhere, with the power level of these combatants, he's going to be sent flying.
Kenobi's going to be sent flying regardless, depending on Anakin's mood.
They have to maintain a careful balance between baiting their opponents to draw them in and triggering the fight's biggest wild card, i.e. Anakin.
That's an understatement. Anakin is the wild card.
But unfortunately for them, hell, unfortunately for everyone, no one is quite aware of just how unstable Anakin really is. Even his master, the one that knows him better than any other, being on their team isn't enough to offset this, as Obi-Wan has demonstrated a bit of a blinker's problem when it comes to Anakin's mental health.
Ironically, Anakin is the most aware of how unstable he is. However, Mace Windu makes note of how the entire council is aware of his instability.
If Anakin's full potential is unleashed, PloBiTi loses.
The question becomes then, is this likely to happen? Answer, probably not.
Does it really need to? At this point, I'm just gonna go to the verdict. For this fight, I will be doing two rounds. The first is Morals On, where Anakin is the same way he is during his time on the Invisible Hand, except he, like Kenobi, will open with their primary forms, with Anakin not fighting at his full capacity. Anakin won't have any reason not to open with Jim So, but he's not going to be drawing on the full use of his Furnace Heart. The second is Morals Off, where Anakin's going Nightfall mode. Let's say the fight takes place in Fenway Park. As a side note to keep in mind, Anakin has been established as a Tier 9, with Kenobi as a Tier 8. I'd place Shaak Ti and Plo Koon as Tier 7s, with Kit Fisto, and I could possibly see Mundi as an 8. With that being said, let's continue the verdict. Anakin starts dinosaur charging towards Team Kenobi. Obi-Wan, knowing what's about to happen, starts backing the fuck up. Shaak Ti moves out of position to prepare to perform hit-and-run tactics. Plo Koon eventually realizes what the fuck is happening, but isn't fast enough to get out of the way. Anakin slams into Plo Koon, and the blur of Anakin's strikes quickly deplete his force reserve the way it did Dooku. Not even getting a chance to resort to anything else, Plo Koon is struck down. Shaak Ti, who breaks off to avoid Anakin steamrolling her, is intercepted by Fisto and Mundi, who start teaming her while Anakin moves onto Kenobi. Ti wouldn't be helpless, but she'd be quickly overwhelmed and cut down. Whereas Kenobi got driven back by a hindered Anakin on Mustafar, an unhindered Skywalker quickly starts to overwhelm him. Kenobi would know what to expect, and knows Anakin's formula better than anyone else. There's only so much he could defend against, especially as Mundi and Fisto trail behind Anakin to provide support if he needs it. Whether Anakin's team wins 10 times out of 10 is something you guys can decide. In round 2, with morals off, it becomes a complete stomp in Anakin's favor, Anakin in Nightfall mode ragdolls T into Coon with ease, leaving them on the ground as they squeal like pigs on fire!
I declare Team Anakin the victors.
Of course, this is my opinion, so if any of you disagree, feel more than welcome to tell me. Even if I didn't change your opinion on the matchup, I hope I gave more context to the argument in Team Anakin's favor, and as to why I think he's one of the most underrated people in the Versus community. This was a very long video to make, and hopefully you guys had as much fun watching it as I did making it. Feel free to leave your suggestions for future video ideas down below. This has been the Nuisance Bird, and I thank you guys for watching.